Good morning, one and all. Welcome to Sunday morning worship at Godalming United Church. Today is the fifth Sunday in Lent. Next week will be Palm Sunday. And in the last week, many of us will have seen significant growth in our gardens and bulbs beginning to bloom. With that thought in mind, we must thank Eileen and her helpers for the distribution of Mothering Sunday daffodils, which they were able to undertake last week. And don't forget to complete your census form today. At times it has been difficult remembering the days and months in lockdown, but I can assure you that although it is Census Day, it is not Christmas. This morning's service includes Holy Communion. A moment's silence before we commence worship.
Good morning, and thank you again for joining us for worship with Godalming United Church. This morning, we have so much to look forward to. It's the first full day of spring. It's only two more weeks until Easter. The UK is continuing to move out of lockdown. Hopefully by now you all have heard the news from the church regarding live worship. Providing the nationwide unlocking proceeds as planned, we will be reopening the church for worship on the 11th of April. Now, I do want to say a few words about this reopening. As you all know, we're not quite back to normal yet. When we are together on the 11th, we will still have to practice social distancing, wear masks, and are not allowed to sing at this time. So worship will look very similar to what it did back in the autumn, which I believe many of us will admit was less than ideal. However, I believe that there is a great need in the community, in the world, for communal worship right now, for social interaction, for gathering together and trying to find some meaning in what we've been through the past year. However, although everyone will be invited to join us that day, not necessarily everyone will be encouraged to join us that day. There is still some risk in gathering together, and perhaps not everyone is comfortable with that risk or even should be comfortable with it. If you don't feel ready to join us, we understand and support that. The online streaming of services has been extremely well received, and we will be continuing to offer service in that way. And so as you plan and pray about whether or not you will join us on the 11th, I invite you to join us for worship today. At the end of our service, we will be celebrating Holy Communion. If you wish to follow along with that, please make sure you have your bread and wine ready after the sermon. For now, let's join together with the call to worship. You are invited to follow along with the words in bold on your screen. Have mercy on your people, O God. Wash us, cleanse us, make us more perfect in your love. Open the skies and pour down grace upon your people. Open our hearts to hear your voice. Let the thunder of your presence awaken us. Have mercy on your people, O God. Restore within us the joy of your salvation. Draw us nearer to you, our Christ. Let's pray. God of love and mercy, open our hearts to your presence as we worship you this day. Whether our prayers are filled with celebration or with loud cries and tears, remind us that you are the source of our eternal salvation. Give us the strength to faithfully respond to your transforming love, that the joy of your salvation might shine in and through us all. Wipe away our wrongdoing. Clean our hearts. Make us more perfect. For it is in your perfect love that we are drawn more fully into your image. Generous and loving God, grant us the wisdom to know you more completely. Give us the hope to live as your people. Inspire us to give of our spirits more fully and the faith that your promise is already with us. As we give our gifts and tithes today, we recommit ourselves to your service and to the service of your people. May we do so in response to your unending call that beckons us and leads us home. Bless us today in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Today's reading is taken from John's Gospel, chapter 11, starting at verse 1 through to 4, and then moving on to verse 17. The death of Lazarus. Now, a man named Lazarus was ill. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay ill, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sisters sent word to Jesus, "Lord, the one you love is ill." When he heard this, Jesus said, "This illness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it." Jesus comforts the sisters of Lazarus. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now, Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she replied, "I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who is to come into the world." After she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. "The teacher is here," she said, "and is asking for you." When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now, Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who had been with Mary in the house comforting her noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying? Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days. Then Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth round his face. Jesus said to them, take off the grave clothes and let him go. Therefore, many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary and had seen what Jesus did, believed in him. This is the word of the Lord.
I read an article in the newspaper a few years back about a woman that had recently lost her mother. She was the executor of her mother's estate, and as so often happened, it was her job to sort through the correspondence and the letters that came in the weeks and the months after her mother's death. One came in from the state, and it seemed that in her later years, her mother had gone on to the food stamp assistant program for the state. And this letter was regarding that. The letter read, Dear Mrs. Brown, I regret to inform you that your food stamp benefits are being rescinded, as we recently received notice that you have passed away. You may reapply if there are changes in your circumstances. Now, this isn't likely to happen, but there have been a few people in history who could reapply based on that criteria. This morning, we're going to be talking about one of them in the person of Lazarus. For the past few Sundays, we've been talking about characters that appear in the gospel stories, and hopefully seeing a bit of ourselves in each one of them. Like Nicodemus, we are so unprepared for God's kingdom that nothing short of rebirth can even help us see it. Like the Samaritan woman at the well, we are parched for living water, but seek to satisfy our thirst with lesser things. And this week, we acknowledge that we are like Lazarus. We are dead. And like him, we have no hope of anything but decay and further death. Lazarus is mentioned only twice in the Bible. And yet in those two times, we are told that he is a good friend to Jesus, one whom Jesus loved. He had met Lazarus and Lazarus' sisters, Mary and Martha, during his travels throughout Judea. They lived in the town of Bethany, just a few miles outside of Jerusalem. And as Jesus is traveling, word comes to him that his friend Lazarus is sick. But unfortunately, Jesus is many miles, a couple of days' walk away. And by the time Jesus arrives, Lazarus is already dead. Jesus asks to be taken to his friend's grave, and he there mourns Lazarus. For Jesus, though, this mourning is not the end. He calls for the tomb to be opened, and then he calls for Lazarus to come forth. There are a couple of points in this very familiar story that I want us to examine this morning and to see how we can see ourselves in this story of Lazarus. The first thing that I want to point out is that the scripture makes very clear that Lazarus was not resuscitated, but resurrected. It may seem a very subtle point, but it's very important. The words died, dead, or death appear 8 times in this story. Lazarus was dead, it said. My brother would not have died, the women said. Dead, dead, dead. It's almost here as if the gospel writer is wanting us to understand that Lazarus was dead. John also tells us that Lazarus has been dead for 4 days. And again, this is reiterating the point, although it may not be as obvious for modern audiences. You see, in the ancient world, it was a common belief that the soul hovered over its body for 3 days after death, hoping to re-enter it. But after those 3 days, it was believed, the soul gave up and made its journey to Sheol. And so when John tells us that Lazarus has been dead 4 days, again he is telling us that it is beyond this time, that Lazarus was dead and that there is no hope of him still being alive. We too are dead. Make no mistake about this. Jesus told his disciples in John 8:21 that they would die in their sin. Paul tells us in Romans 8:10 that our bodies are dead because of sin. In the ancient Near Eastern world, death was called the land of no return. And it was viewed as this inescapable underworld prison. The Old Testament pictures the realm of death as Sheol as being under the earth, comparing its entrance to a deep pit. And those that descend into this subterranean region are cut off from God's mighty deeds. They're cut off from the worshiping community of faith. And in the ancient world, they believed that the entrance to this world was through the tomb. And so all hope for Lazarus here is gone, at least as far as they knew. The second point I want to make is that it is before this tomb that Jesus wept. Now, much has been made about this. It's the shortest verse in all of English scripture. But it's not the only time where we see Jesus crying. We're told that he wept when he approached the city of Jerusalem for the final time and predicted its destruction by the Romans. He wept for himself in the garden when he considered what was awaiting him in the hours and day ahead. We often think about God as being removed, unemotional. And this has, unfortunately, crept into Christianity from the Greek religion, where God had no messy attachment to human beings, where God was other, where God was stoic. But here we see that God cares for us. He cares when we hurt. He cares when we mourn. He cares when we grieve. Final point I want us to see is that Jesus did not raise Lazarus alone. Now, that may sound a bit counterintuitive to us at first. Of course, Jesus raised Lazarus alone. He was the only one that could do it. But notice that Jesus didn't roll the stone away himself. He could have. He could have waved his hand and moved it out of the way. He could have called down angels to move the tomb as he did for his own resurrection. But instead, we're told that he enlisted the other people to roll the stone away. And when Lazarus stumbled out of the tomb, still wrapped in his shroud, Jesus again had others unbind him. Jesus restored Lazarus to life, but he called on the community to complete what he had begun. So it is with our Christian life in faith. We are buried with Christ. We are dead to sin. We are raised with him to walk in the newness of life. But we are never alone. God has given us the church. He has given us the gathering, the community of believers to walk with us and to support us on this journey. And for those of us that have been Christians for many years, he is calling upon us to support others. I'd like you to think about that this morning as we enter into our time of Holy Communion. It's a time for remembering Jesus' sacrifice for us, for remembering our own mortality, but also about remembering the good news that we are offered, that we are given eternal life through Jesus Christ. Eternal life where we are reunited with God, where we are reunited with our family. Eternal life that changes our life here upon this earth as we journey into faith with those who walk with us. Christ invites to his table all who love him and seek to grow in his likeness. Let us draw near with faith, make our humble confession, and prepare to receive this holy sacrament. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That is proof of God's love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Lift up your hearts and give thanks to the Lord our God. Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, you made us in your image to love and be loved. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. By the suffering, death, and resurrection of your only Son, Jesus Christ, you delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves as in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us. Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. This is my body, which is broken for you. Take now and eat. This is my blood, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Take now and drink. And as often as you do so in remembrance of me. Let's pray. Most bountiful God, we give you thanks for the world you have created, for the gift of life, and for giving yourself to us in Jesus Christ, whose holy life, suffering and death, and glorious resurrection have delivered us from slavery to sin and death. We thank you that in the power of your Holy Spirit, you have fed us in this sacrament, united us with Christ, and given us a foretaste of your heavenly banquet. We are your children, and yours is the glory, now and forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you. across the country on Tuesday the 23rd, on the first anniversary of the UK lockdown, the nation will be joining together for a National Day of Reflection organised by Marie Curie to commemorate the tragic loss of life and to stand together with everyone who is grieving. As Christians, we are asked to both reflect and pray, and churches are invited to be prayerful 1 year on from the start of the first lockdown. There'll be a minute's silence at 12 noon that day, followed by a ringing of church bells, and later a doorstep vigil at 8 p.m. This National Day of Reflection looks to reflect on our collective loss, support those who've been bereaved, and hope for a brighter future. I've taken the prayers today from sections of the prayers arranged by the World Council of Churches, entitled Voices of Lament, Hope and Courage. A week of prayer in the time of the COVID-19 pandemic. And during the week, you can follow these prayers on the website shown. Let us pray. Eternal God, as we come before you on this day, we place our hope in you, our rock, our salvation, our refuge. May we pour out our hearts in this time of prayer, trusting in your steadfast love. May the source of our inspiration be Christ Jesus, who in his love of the poorest and most needy demonstrated welcome and inclusion. May we do everything we do as if we are doing it to Jesus, and because we are one in his Spirit, in whose power we pray. God of all, we pray that our local congregations may find ways to model the love of Christ in their communities that struggle with illness and death due to the pandemic. In this great work of care, may we work to bridge the political, economic and racial inequalities that exist and contribute to the suffering brought by the pandemic. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray that the spirit of unity and peace would bring healing and resilience. May your people continue to abide under the shadow of your strength as they take shelter in you, placing their trust in your deliverance. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving Lord, grant help to communities living in fear, so that they will be strengthened as they face the threats of job losses, hunger, bereavement and disease. Grant them courage and hope. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Compassionate God, we bring before you today those within our global family for whom physical distancing is impossible. We pray for your gracious protection on them. Through this global crisis, may we all be drawn closer to you and so closer to each other. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As faith communities, may we find ways to show and witness to the love of God in Jesus Christ to all among us who are hurting. May we have the courage and gifts to be the body of the risen one in this time of our world's suffering. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty and faithful God, give leaders your divine wisdom in the exercise of their authority. Might they always seek to serve with humility and to act justly. Broaden the vision of all leaders so that they will see beyond the parochial borders. May your love and compassion envelop their hearts, enabling them to look after the interests of others with diligence. May they not grow weary in doing good, in serving all with joy and a sense of purpose. We pray for leaders who serve in every capacity and at every level: churches, government and civic organisations, finance, health, education. Lord, we pray that the leaders of different faith communities, leaders from the government and the scientific community work together with humility and mutual respect across boundaries and borders to overcome this pandemic. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for leaders of the pharmaceutical industries, states and interstate organisations, that access to the vaccination against COVID-19 may be granted to the most vulnerable everywhere, regardless of their purchasing power. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We have also been asked today by our parent denominations to pray for the people of Myanmar. And I've used the prayers by Martin Snow, Bishop of Leicester. God of all mercy, who comforts us in our suffering and strengthens us to support those in need, we cry out to you for the people of Myanmar, for those who are grieving the loss of loved ones and those who are protesting for peace. Grant them courage and perseverance, and turn the hearts of the military towards the people they have pledged to protect, that justice and mercy may rule in this land. We ask this in the name of our Saviour, Jesus Christ, who came to serve and gave his life as a ransom for many. Amen. And now, time of personal prayer for ourselves and for those known to us. Lord, we lift up our friends, families, situations close to our hearts, and our own needs of your healing, comfort and strength. In our church community at this time, we remember Alan and Janet and Margaret in hospital recovering after her fall and her operation. In a moment of quiet, we lift them all before you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We say together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
And now for our benediction. In anticipation of the transforming love of God, the salvation of Jesus Christ, and the mercy of the ever-present Holy Spirit, may you hear the voice of God speaking in your life this week. May you be restored to the joy of your salvation as Jesus calls us to come out of our tombs and live our lives fully in Him. Go in peace, and I'll see you next week.